Good morning, everyone. Can I ask you to take your seat so that we can start? And welcome to the second day on the ECB Forum on the future of international monetary and financial architecture. Yesterday's contributions were very interesting and led to a lively debate, as much in the rooms here as outside, and I trust that you all appreciated the time you had in the afternoon to further your conversations. It certainly didn't look like much of free time, but rather fruitful time. So today, we're shifting the focus to the regulatory perspective, and I trust this will be just as inspiring as yesterday. Before I give the floor to Benoît Cœuré, and as for those who hadn't heard it yesterday, we had to make a change due to Sabine falling in. I would just like to quickly remind everyone of the rules on media. Everything here is on the record and can be reported upon live. Everything that is on the sidelines is off the record. And also a last plea, you all know the games of numbers. We do need your voting on the posters to have a good representative view. And you have time until 11:30 to do so today. I now hand over to Benoît Cœuré, who will chair session number 2, Financial Regulatory Challenges. Over to you, Benoît.
Thank you, Christine. Good morning to all of you. I'm not Sabine Lautenschläger, as you've seen, which is certainly bad for the substantial quality of this panel, because you won't have the supervisory angle into that discussion, or you will have it from the speakers, but not from the ECB, since I'm sitting clearly on the other side of the ECB, which is the monetary policy side. Nevertheless, the monetary policy side of the ECB has an interest in sound regulation, that's why I'm looking forward to hearing from the speakers. This is a session on global financial regulatory challenges. We'll have two presentations. The first presentation by Darrel, focusing on regulation, and the second presentation by Stijn on financial structures. Darrel will be commented by Charles, and Stijn will be commented by Hyun. What I would expect from that discussion is not only the speakers shedding light on what are the most efficient structures, in particular in the Eurozone, which is our focus here, but also in other places, what's good for financial stability, but also I would plea not to lose sight of the cross-border perspective. That is the theme of the conference is about global coordination, global consistency. So it's very important that this session can also address cross-border consistency, level playing field, in particular when it comes to what has been achieved on the regulatory side. So what has been consistent, what has not been consistent, and what can be improved. And also in the light of the discussions we're having with the industry, also have some sense of the timeline and horizon. That is, how far have we advanced in this regulatory reform process? Are we close from reaching the steady state, or not at all? Because that's a message that the industry is very eager to listen. How much remains to be done? Will we need new waves of regulation? Are we close to the end? The industry talks of Basel IV, which we don't like, so we say there is no Basel IV, but there are fears in the industry that there would be a Basel IV. And what's really the value of that discussion is to bring answers that are not based on partial equilibrium, special interest thinking, which is unfortunately the way most of the discussion has been structured in different places, but really to bring the general equilibrium and welfare, social welfare perspective. That's very much what we want to hear from you. So now, Darrel, with a due delay, I give you the floor.
Thank you, Benoît. Good morning, everyone. Bon dia. It's great to see so many familiar faces and meet so many new friends. I want to get started right away on this very interesting and challenging assignment that the European Central Bank gave to me, which is to give you an assessment, or at least my assessment, of progress with financial regulation since the crisis. As you know, in 2009, in Pittsburgh, the G20 met and set out a very ambitious program of reform. I've broken it into five areas. The first four on financial stability are verbatim from the Financial Stability Board's progress reports. They monitor progress on each of these basic core elements, they call them, of financial stability improvements across the G20. I recommend their report. So these are making financial institutions more resilient, ending too big to fail, making derivatives markets safer, and transforming shadow banking. Now, there is no financial efficiency board, but if there were one, it would have listed the fifth core element of the G20 reform, which is improving trade competition. Now, clearly, in the short time that we have together this morning, I'm not going to go through all of these. I'm just going to pick a few salient areas where there has been a lot of progress and a few areas where improvements could be made or more progress could be made. And so if you're thinking in terms of where are we, maybe half done. I won't use sports analogies. The first one I'm going to focus on is making financial institutions more resilient. I'll do that briefly. Then if we'll have time, I'll talk a little bit about making derivatives markets safer, and then a little bit about improving trade competition, which is an area in which I do a lot of research lately. So making financial institutions more resilient, let me just give you one example of the really excellent progress that has been made through the Basel III program. I'll pick Europe. On this chart from the European Banking Authority, you can see in red the fraction of banks whose core equity tier 1 capital ratios are below 9%. Those are essentially disappeared. And the good news is the green, those are the banks whose CET1 ratios are above 12%, are now the norm. Now, this is not to say that the work is all done. Because of the events of last Thursday and Friday, I decided to take a quick peek at the largest European banks based on market capitalization, and the numbers there are not good. Some of the very largest European banks have market capitalization to book ratios of on the order of 25%. One particularly large bank in Europe has market capitalization which is only 1% of its assets. And I have the feeling that this is not so much about the solvency of these banks as their balance sheets stand today, but the prospects for profitability going forward. And as you know, one of these can turn into the other over time. So there's a lot more work to be done in this area, but let me dive ahead and discuss the trade-off between resiliency improvements and the impact on market efficiency and capital markets, because capital markets are facilitated by bank dealers. And this trade-off, in my view, is well worth it. We've got a lot more resiliency. The amount of market liquidity that we've lost is correspondingly not that big. So it's a good trade-off, but that doesn't mean that there's no trade-off. And I want to focus a little bit on what the trade-off might be. And I'm even going to grant the Modigliani-Miller theorem as a given and look at another conceptual foundation for where market efficiency might be impaired due to a different part of finance theory, which is called debt overhang. This is a concept introduced by Stuart Myers of MIT in 1977. So imagine, if you will, the balance sheet of a major dealer bank. I'm going to focus on market value now, not book values. We have assets, debt, and equity of some initial market value. And now I'm going to conduct two experiments, one purely abstract and one realistic. The abstract one will be this one. The bank is considering purchasing some new market-making assets. And hypothetically, again, this is only abstract, it will fund the purchase by issuing new equity. So this is a very onerous, for some reason, the capital requirement is so high that it's all new equity. So one for one new equity. The right-hand side is the new balance sheet. And if you either remember your corporate finance 101 or you have extremely good eyesight, you should be able to detect that the blue block, the market value of debt, is now at least a bit higher. Why? Well, because the same creditors are backed by more assets. The new equity was one-to-one with the new assets. The only way this can add up is if the old equity shareholders have lost some money. They've made a value transfer to the creditors. And I'm going to help you here by drawing in the lines so you can see this tiny sliver of value transfer. Now let's explore incentives. Why would the legacy shareholders of this bank conduct this transaction? Well, they wouldn't on the basis shown. They lose money. But if they're a dealer bank, they buy low, sell high with a bid-ask spread. So now the question is, can they buy these new assets with a bid-ask spread profit that's wide enough to overcome this value transfer? And that's the proposition that we're looking at, I think, especially in the area of safe asset intermediation. So now I'm going to conduct the realistic experiment of safe asset intermediation. Here's the experiment. We're going to talk about repo intermediation. This is when a large bank supplies liquidity to the securities market by taking in treasury securities or bunds, let's say a German bunds, collateralizing a cash provision. Now, this is an extremely safe transaction. The cash provided is more than collateralized by bunds, which, by all accounts, are very safe instruments. There should be no economic, no significant, at least economic, increase in risk to the creditors. However, under the new rule called the leverage ratio, or particularly for the largest banks called the supplementary leverage ratio, any addition to the balance sheet of assets must be accompanied by a uniform additional amount of equity. It's 3% for the largest European banks, 5% for the dealers of the US banks. Again, regardless of the risk. Now, if you need to add a lot of equity for an essentially risk-free trade, that means, again, the creditors of this bank will be very happy. Their debts are now safer. And the only way this adds up is if the equity shareholders give up some value. They will be willing to do this only if the bid-ask spread in the repo market is big enough to overcome this debt overhang value transfer. There's a very simple model in the back of my paper that explains why the widening of the bid-ask spread for this requirement is twice the leverage ratio times the credit spread of the bank, which in Europe is now between 150 and 180 for the largest banks. It went up about 40 basis points in the last few days. So how much is that? Well, it's much less than the banks have claimed. They're multiplying the capital ratio by the return on equity, which is a huge number, and that's a ridiculous claim. But it's still, for the repo market, a big enough impact on the incentive to intermediate the repo market that it's killing, at least in the US, the liquidity of the government securities repo market. Here is the increase in the bid-ask spread in the US government securities repo market since the imposition of the supplementary leverage ratio. It's traditionally, in both the US and Europe, it's been under 5 basis points, 3 to 4 basis points. And now in the United States, it's in excess of 15 to 16 basis points. Doesn't seem like much, but with a bid-ask spread of a few basis points, this has basically caused the largest banks not to want to do this trade unless it's subsidized by some other trade. And you can see from these data provided by Antoine Martin of the Federal Reserve Bank of New York that the provision of liquidity by the largest bank dealers to the non-bank dealers has shrunk dramatically. The amount of cash provided in this market is down about 75% since the implementation of the SLR in the US. In Europe, ICMA, which is the private market association that has been complaining significantly about the European situation in this regard, has data, which I got from the ECB, showing only a minor reduction in the total amount of repo done in Europe. And I think that's due to some differences between the US and Europe, and also the fact, as I mentioned, that the SLR in Europe is less than in the US. You can read my paper to get more details. So now I'm going to go from this area of resiliency and talk a little bit about making derivatives markets safer and then trade competition. So making derivatives markets safer, the flagship regulation of this area in the G20 is central clearing. And it has been very successful. This is a big improvement in the safety and soundness of the derivatives markets. Roughly two-thirds of US swaps are now centrally cleared. Europe is beginning to centrally clear by requirement this month in the interest rate swap market. Europe has been in the whole area of derivatives markets and trade competition moving more slowly than the United States. And that's partly because Europe has been too slow and the US has been too fast in the sense of extraterritoriality. One of the areas of concern in this area is that now we've created these central counterparties, will they be safe? And my report goes into that in detail. I hope it will come up during the discussion. Benoît is one of the experts. I recommend his speech at the ESRB 2 weeks ago showing progress in this area. But the progress is far from complete, especially in the United States, where failure resolution is not even, at least in public, on the agenda. That is administrative failure resolution. Another big improvement in the derivatives markets is that the imposition of those new resiliency requirements of capital and margin is forcing down the outstanding amounts of derivatives exposures in the market. This is a private sector initiative that's in response. This is not itself a quantity-based reduction by regulation. This is the incentives provided by capital regulation and margin requirements on getting the dealers to push down the outstanding amounts of derivatives without a loss in number of transactions, or not much of a loss. So the amount of risk relative to the amount of trading is well down, and it continues to go down for reasons described in my paper. Now I'm going to get to my last topic, which is trade competition. And the main initiative, G20 initiative in this area, is focused on the bond and swap markets, over-the-counter markets. And the idea is to reduce the inefficiencies associated with an oligopolistic and opaque, inefficient, bilateral dealer-intermediated market. In this schematic, the blue dots are the buy-side firms, the hedge funds, the corporations, the pension funds, insurance companies. The green dots are the major dealers. They take requests for trade from the blue dots, and they intermediate those, and they lay off the risks in the interdealer market. This is very inefficient because of the local monopoly power that a dealer has when a client faces the dealer, and because there's not much price transparency, or at least there wasn't pre-crisis. The reforms are in two areas. Number one, push the trading onto central venues like this one, a central limit order book market, or other venues that I'll talk about in a moment. The second initiative is post-trade price transparency, so that when you can see the going price in the market, you're in a better position as a buy-side firm to shop around, to turn down a trade, bid, or offer. You'll be able to compete, you'll be able to create more competition for your trade request. Now, the market hasn't really gone very far in the direction illustrated here of a central limit order book market. Rather, what it's been doing in both the US and Europe is to go to market trading platforms, sometimes called market trading facilities, or SEFs, swap execution facilities for bonds and swaps, where the customer sends a request for quote to a small subset of dealers who provide bids and offers. And now at least the customer can take the better of the two in this diagram. Remember, the customer is not doing all-to-all trade. The customer cannot be a provider of liquidity. It can only be a requester for liquidity, which lowers market efficiency. The problem, and the main problem, other than the fact that this is not a central limit order book market, is that we have extreme fragmentation. Trade is divided across different trading platforms. Part of this is that there is no incentive for the dealers to combine their trading platforms, because that would only introduce more competition, which doesn't benefit the dealers. And partly it's due to the lack of harmonization of regulation between the United States and Europe. And this is probably not where to get into that. There has been some progress made, but basically the regulations are not so far encouraging more trade on the same platforms. And with the events of Brexit, this could become even worse, since London is the, currently at least for the time being, currently the most important trading center for bonds and swaps. And that implies probably greater fragmentation. I mentioned central clearing. There could be greater fragmentation in that area as well. President Hollande yesterday suggested that central clearing of Eurozone swaps should take place in Europe, in the Eurozone, the new Europe, new European Union. And I think that's a natural outcome, although there will be some costs. Just to give you an idea of how much benefit there is to create more trade competition on the same platform, I refer you to some work by Terry Hendershot and Anant Madhavan, who, controlling for other factors, estimates the trading costs of a buy-side firm for buying corporate bonds or selling corporate bonds on a trading platform in which the buy-side firm is able to generate N quotes, where N can vary. And the point of this diagram is that the cost to the buy-side firm of execution goes down dramatically as the number of quote providers goes up. Now, this is no shock to anyone in the room, because we all took economics. You know that if you have an auction among more bidders, that the seller in the auction, the initiator of the auction, is going to get a better price. No shock at all. But yet, we're dealing with fragmentation, and it's going to be hard to eliminate it. The buy side hasn't coordinated itself to demand this kind of consolidation of trading platforms, and that needs to happen. I expect it will happen. The private sector is good at this. It will just take a while for the buy side firms to initiate this. So what we've ended up with, in effect, in response to this last major regulatory initiative for better trade competition, is what's known as a two-tiered market, meaning fragmentation in which the ultimate investors are obtaining a small number of quotes on the periphery of the market, and the dealers are providing those quotes. There's no all-to-all trade, except among the dealers themselves, who, of course, are smart enough to know that they get better execution and faster, more liquid execution if they themselves have all-to-all trading on their own central limit order books. And you might ask, well, what prevents the buy-side firms from simply applying for membership on these all-to-all platforms in the middle of this market? Nothing in law prevents that. However, there are some institutional impediments to it, which I describe in my paper. And maybe that will come up in the Q&A. So just to sum up, I've given you only a very high level view in several areas of progress with financial regulation. It's been a major reform project, but there is a lot more to do. I have some very specific criticisms in my report of how we have ended up in a number of areas. I'm not going to detail those now. This is not hard to give an overarching catalog when the issues are piece by piece. One issue I would point you towards is foreign exchange derivatives. We don't have safer derivatives markets in that area. That deserves attention. The too big to fail failure resolution project is a wonderful project. It's well on its way, but in the position of someone who actually needs to press the button on failure resolution for a very large, complicated bank. I explain in my report why that's not yet ready for deployment. And Charles actually has a paper on this. Maybe he'll have the time to bring that up during his discussion. There's a number of other areas that I cover in my report. But for now, I'm just going to thank you for the opportunity to speak with you. And I look forward to hearing what the rest of this panel has to say. Thank you.
Dearly beloved brethren, let me start by leading you in prayer. Lord, forgive us, because we have done those things we ought not to have done, and we have not done those things we ought to have done. And life is full of sins of commission and omission. Now, Darrel has mostly focused on the sins of commission, things that have been done in trying to improve and reform regulation, and that have turned out to be somewhat difficult or not entirely going to plan. Now, on the whole, I agree with his assessments, and in certain areas, particularly derivatives and money markets, Darrel is really the world leading academic expert, and I sit at his feet and try and learn from him. And I have very little to say either about Darrel's presentation or his paper. With one exception, which I shall come to later. So what I want to talk about today is rather the sins of omission. In other words, what has not been done, what has not been attempted by the authorities outside of the four core elements that Darrel has talked about in his paper. Now, the first of these is housing finance. Now, in his executive summary, Darrel states, and I quote, "The biggest underlying source of risk to the financial systems were poorly monitored and excessive residential finance." And Stijn, Claessens, in his paper coming up, adds, and I quote, "A big item here is the amount and form of housing finance given, besides its large role in booms and busts, given its limited productive impact." And as many, including John Buehlbauer in the audience, and Mian and Sufi, in a recent NBER working paper have noted, it is the collapse of housing prices that caused first-order real distress in financially-driven downturns. So the form, amount, and regulation of housing finance is a big issue. What has been done directly to tame the boom and bust cycle of credit-financed real estate? My answer would be not much at all. There's been some sporadic, but not comprehensive, increase in the allocation of macroprudential powers to some, but not all, central banks. But I rather doubt whether they will be applied strongly enough to work effectively. It's not only Brainard caution. If you don't know exactly what you're doing and you haven't tried this out before, you tend to do it very gently. It's rather that I don't think it will be undertaken sufficiently aggressive. Governor Mark Carney speaks with pride about having managed to achieve a multiplication of the size of the Tier 1 core equity ratio in UK banks of about 10 times. And he claims that this hasn't had very much effect on total bank lending to the private sector. Now, compare that with the kind of counter-cyclical increase in capital ratios that are considered under the sort of macro-prudential arrangements for dealing with housing prices. It's a fraction, a small fraction, of the amount of increase in core tier equity. And this is going to be introduced at a time when the housing market is booming and people expect housing prices to go on up. Is it likely under these circumstances that it will have very much effect on the provision by banks of housing finance? Now, I've lived through three financial crises in the UK, 73, 74, the fringe bank crisis, the ERM crisis in 91-92, and now the great financial crisis in 2008-9. All of these were effectively centered on real estate, residential and commercial. You will have noted that they are 17 years apart. Undertaking the standard econometric assumption that the future will be exactly like the past, I can therefore, with considerable confidence, guarantee that you can pencil in the next financial crisis in 2025. Not quite yet certain about the month, but perhaps within shortly I'll be able to tell you that as well. Now, it's not as if there was no suggestions about to improve how to improve housing finance. We could try to move much more towards the Danish covered bond system. Mian and Sufi have suggested the shared responsibility mortgage. But rather than attempting to improve the structure of finance, particularly housing finance, it still remains privileged. As, for example, in the net stable funding ratio. And again, let me quote, in this, unencumbered residential mortgages with a residual maturity of 1 year or more and with a risk weight of less than or equal to 35% under the standardized approach get a required stable funding ratio of 65%, considerably less than other loans, certainly of other loans of the same kind of maturity. For another indication of total inertia in this field, recognize that there has really been no advance at all in trying to reform and decide what to deal with Fannie and Freddie in the United States. If we've got to give a date or a turning point to the moment that shifted us from a relatively stable to a relatively unstable system of housing finance, it is, I would propose, the time when there was a switch from a system of mortgage finance provided by a group of dedicated financial specialists and mutual and conservative institutions like the building societies and the SNLs, financed almost entirely by sticky personal deposits, to mortgage finance provided by limited liability, profit-maximizing banks and shadow banks, financed not only at the margin, but to a very large extent by informed, uninsured, very short-term wholesale deposits ready to flee at a moment's notice. We haven't done very much to deal with that. And that brings me to my second point, which is the unwillingness of the regulatory authorities to intervene in matters of governance and remuneration. It's been a matter of surprise to me always that the regulators have been prepared to deal at some considerable detail with capital ratios, liquidity ratios, risk modeling, risk management procedures, et cetera, but refrain from interfering in those matters, such as governance and remuneration, that much more fundamentally influence personal incentives and therefore business decisions. Oceans of ink have been spilt on examining and deploring the incentive and moral hazard effect of deposit insurance, whereas much less attention has been paid to the much more powerful and similar implications of limited liability, especially on those in a position to influence a bank's decision and in situations with the debt overhang that Darrel talked about in his presentation. Now that bail-inable creditors face a risk of being switched into the position of being equity holders willy-nilly and not at a time or an occasion of their own choosing, should they not also be given a much larger say and vote on the direction of the bank's management? My own worry is that the proposed system of bank bail-in may not survive a widespread systemic crisis because of its likely adverse effects on financial markets generally, of which events earlier this year in January gave us really something of a foretaste. In my view, bailout has been the best and simplest and most effective method of stopping a financial disaster, and hence the best possible use, as TARP was, of taxpayer money. But that's now prevented by a political and social and public backlash. But did the politicians and public really want their financial and banking system to be closed and shuttered? Was the fury directed not so much at the salvation of the banks, but rather at the rescue of the bankers? Perhaps what we should aspire to is a return of all the SIFIs to a condition of partnership, where the executive decision makers, the partners, have in effect unlimited or much greater liability than is provided by limited liability. So that if a bank has to be bailed out, the partners should pay up all, or at least a great proportion, of their what they have. Clawback has been a step in the right direction, but only a pretty small step where the distance yet to travel is much greater. So can I leave you with a thought that the main problems of financial stability lie in governance and incentives rather than in the details of capital and liquidity requirements? Not that I object to the latter, but I don't think that they're dealing with the, if you like, the fundamental problems. But before I finally sit down, may I just comment on one aspect of Darrel's masterful paper. Now, he notes, quoting the Bank of England's Financial Policy Committee, that the leverage ratio is meant as a backstop for the risk-weighted asset capital requirement, because regulatory risk may not vary sufficiently with the true riskiness of assets. And that's, of course, true. But I think that the case for applying a leverage ratio as a main element goes much further than that. As Charlie Calamiris and others have shown, the leverage ratio was a reasonable predictor of failure in the GFC, where the risk-asset ratio was simply not. Moreover, the basic leverage ratio is in some respect and in principle simple, whereas the risk-asset ratio is complex and subject to politically inspired capture, and not least by the housing industry. Now, while it is certainly the case, as Darrel argues, that a leverage ratio discriminates against low-profit, high-asset activities with certain adverse consequences for the liquidity of some key money markets, including the US GCF repo ratio, a repo market, I would not want to respond to that concern by reinserting some risk weightings into the leverage ratio by the back door. Where the leverage ratio calculation is in any case anything but simple lies in its allowance for netting offsetting positions. And as Darrel shows quite rightly, the reason why all this is low risk is because it's effectively, the positions are effectively hedged by offsetting positions. So of Darrel's various proposals for dealing with this issue, my own preference would be very much for a much more liberal and constructive approach to netting allowances in this and similar markets, rather than for introducing some form of risk weighting into the otherwise relatively simple leverage ratio approach. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Charles. We now move to financial structures, and Stijn will present his views.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me to be here and to present. I should start, however, with the disclaimer that what I'm going to present are not the views necessarily of the Federal Reserve Board. So the topic given to me is regulation and structural change in financial systems, which is a big topic, and it's not an easy one to analyze. We have seen many changes in financial systems over the past few decades, some of them due to cyclical factors, the global financial crisis, some of them due to regulations. So in my paper, I try to distinguish the more longer-term trends. The way I do that, looking at the demand side, what do we see in changes in terms of the economy? What do we see on the supply side in terms of financial service provision, the intra-financial system changes? I also want to look at regulatory trends that have been going on for longer periods of time that have been driving some of these changes. And all of this, of course, is endogenous, so it's very hard to tease out cause and effect. The objective I have is to look at what's the optimal financial system a decade from now, a very tough challenge, and trying to improve both on growth and financial stability objectives. I think we realize that we want both, obviously. I'm not going to give you categorical, very clear regulatory actions. It's going to be more in the form of guideposts as to what we may need to do and where we need to focus on. So lens of analysis, as I said, is financial structure. So I'm going to spend a little bit of time on what they are and how we can define them, but also, more importantly, what do they mean for growth and financial stability. I'm going to do a little bit of a reference to the G4, Euro area, Japan, UK, and US in terms of what the structures are there. And then we're going to talk about the empirical findings that we have, focusing a little bit on the complementarities between financial services, because I think that's where we've seen much kind of new emphasis. Technology has given us much of that complementarity, but it has come with the cost of volatility and procyclicality, and that's really the core of my paper, is trying to see how can we balance that beneficial complementarity with the volatility that may come along with it. And so that's where I'm going to end up discussing regulatory trends and as to where we may need to go forward. So in terms of the analytics of financial structure, there are many distinctions one can make. I mean, the banks versus markets is obviously the one that we're most familiar with, the different ways in which risks is being allocated, information is being shared, relationships versus hard transaction-based lending. We know that very well, and it's an important distinction, but we can make other distinctions as well. I mean, is the system involved in payments or credit or insurance? Is the system giving loans to the corporate sector or to the government or to the housing? Or is the system getting financing from retail, wholesale, or post? So there are many distinctions. I'm not even talking about kind of the industrial organization of a financial system in terms of concentration, number of players, foreign domestic ownership. So obviously a lot of areas to discuss. I'm only going to pick out a few, particularly the bank versus market-based. All of this, of course, in the context that financial structure matters. We're not in the first best. We have many frictions. We have enforcement, information issues. We have a host of reasons why financial structure may make a difference for both growth and for stability. It's kind of the corporate finance question of what do you need, a mix of debt and equity? Yes, we do, because we have certain financial frictions. The focus, however, in the research has been largely been on the demand side, I would say, in terms of what the impact is of these structures on growth and the like. It's been less on the supply side, and I think a lot of what we've seen in the last decades has come from the supply side. This technology-driven complementarities have increased in the financial system, and that's one of the reasons why we've seen more problems in recent years. Now, just a quick review. What do we know about the bank versus market-based distinction? We do know as income rises that banks become less important. The chart on the right shows advanced countries have a lot smaller share of banks in blue as a total share of financial assets compared to emerging markets and developing countries. And we also know that over time, the complementarities on the supply side have probably been increasing, which has been one of the reasons why we've seen more market finance in most of the countries. Although there are exceptions, and even among the G4, we know very well that within the G4, and in the chart on the left shows you the US being a lot less bank-based compared to the Euro area, Japan, and the UK. And there's really a striking difference that we still, although we have very similar levels of development, we see these large differences. Now, one could argue within the Euro area, we really have to look at the financial centers because they provide services among for the whole group, but even if you do it on a weighted basis, we still see the euro area and the EU much more bank-based than the US. Part of the complementarities, not always for the better, has been shadow banking that had been growing before the crisis, been interrupted both in absolute terms as share of GDP and relative to banking in the G4s, but it's been on the rise again. And again, it's a complementarity that's increasingly important to take into account. Allocation of lending, I'm not going to speak much about. It's an important difference even among the G4s. We know US has much less corporate credit and more housing, although the crisis has brought it down a little bit. And as Charles has said, the impact of finance in terms of where it goes obviously is quite different between the different forms of credit. But I'm not going to speak too much about that. I do want to say about the overall effect on growth, I think that's the really the emphasis that we would want to keep in mind, particularly in the euro area where we have had low growth for some time now. What is the distinction here, for example, between banks and markets in terms of growth impact? Initially, the view was that there's no difference. As long as you have good property rights, whether you're banks versus markets, all of it works. I think we've come back from that and saying, listen, depending on the level of development, the level of your income, you might want to prefer a certain mix of banks versus markets, with a mix shifting towards markets as your income level rises, because that's at the margin give you greater impact in terms of growth. Again, I'm going to skip over the destination of the financing. In terms of stability, the view, I think, has been for a long time. Diversity, more market-based, is a better buffer, a better, less crisis prone system, but also a system that recovers faster from a crisis. So we want the diversity as much as possible. We don't want it to, in the perverse way, in the sense of the shadow banking, bad way, but we do want that diversity in many ways, this spare wheel, as long as we can keep the pro-cyclicality managed to some degree. And again, I'm not going to talk about finance in terms of the level of development. I think we know now that we don't want too large a financial system, because then there are declining returns and maybe even negative returns beyond a certain level of debt. I'm going to give you a little bit of a few empirical charts on this topic. So if you look at the left, you see bank credit. On the right, you see stock market credit. This is organized on the horizontal axis by percentile quantiles of income levels. So the richest countries are on the right, which have in green the highest level of bank and the highest level of stock market development, obviously. And then the blue line gives you the marginal impact of an extra dollar of bank or stock market development for a given level of income. So if you're in the lowest bucket, you see that in terms of bank development, you get a higher return from that bank development in terms of growth, but it diminishes over time if you get more richer. The marginal return from that bank development is less. Conversely, in the stock market, it's the opposite. As you get richer, you get more growth benefits out of a marginal return of a stock market development. Obviously, there are lots of endogeneities and causalities. People have controlled for those, but with all the caveats, it seems to be a fact that is an important one to keep in mind. So the growth story, I think, is a fairly straightforward one. The complementarity part of it is a little bit more complicated, in the sense that if we see complementarities, we would like them to see the growth to be higher if stock markets are more developed, and in addition to that, banks are more developed, because then we have a complementarity on the growth side. Now, that used to be there before 1999. That's the chart on the left side, where you see the increase as you move up in the scale of bank and stock market development at the same time. That complementarity seemed to have disappeared after 1999. So although I keep mentioning the complementarities on the supply side, we haven't seen the growth impact as much of those complementarities, and partly because I think we had some perverse complementarities between banks and markets as a shadow banking. Nevertheless, we do want these complementarities, because a lot of economies of scope, there's a lot of funding reasons why banks need capital markets, but also on the securitization side. So we do want this mix to be there. We want it to be there in a productive way. Lastly, on the stability side, I think by now the record is very clear and obvious that market-based systems are much more stable, but also have a better recovery record and are less prone to large and deep recessions. The charts here show you, both for credit crunches and for equity busts that coincide with recessions, how long they last in number of quarters on the left side and how deep they are in terms of the cumulative losses. And the one thing that stands out from this chart, that on the whole there's not much of a difference, but the cumulative loss of a recession in a bank-based system that combines with the credit crunch is much, much higher. There's a cumulative loss of 16%. Whereas the equity bust in a market-based system, not worse, it's still actually the case that in bank-based systems, even equity busts are worse. So from a diversity point of view, you do want to have a much more balanced system, a much more market-based system. A lot of it comes from the housing, as we mentioned, and Charles reiterated as well. So we need to keep that particularly in mind. But it comes with this somewhat increased volatility, and that is an issue that a market-based system is something to be careful for. The chart here shows you the degree to which leverage growth and asset growth correlates. So in some sense, it's asking the question, if you have a shock to capital for whatever reason, an asset price increase or a decrease, what does it mean for the bank's asset growth, leverage growth, translating in terms of new lending, in terms of more intermediation? And you see that in banks that are in market-based economies have a twice as high elasticity, twice higher response rate to a shock to capital than banks that are in bank-based systems. So there's a little bit more procyclicality in terms of those environments, and Tobias Adrian and Yun Shin have really emphasized it for US, but it's a pattern that comes across all market-based systems. So there's a trade-off here that you may have some short-run volatility, procyclicality introduced. And more generally, I think with more market-based, we have more fragmentation, we have more diversity, so we could expect more both asset price volatility, more peak pricing, more shorter horizons that come along with some risks. So there are concerns. So how are we going to basically balance those concerns about volatility, procyclicality, with a desire for more market-based, for growth and other reasons? We do want less bank-based. We do want less, of course, too big to fail, all the issues that Darrel already has mentioned. But we also want a little bit more innovative financing, more market-based at the same time, with fewer perverse links. And the question is the transition. Can we go from a largely bank-based system in Europe and other countries towards a more market-based oriented system? Do the regulatory trends support that? And I think on the whole, yes, to some degree, but I think we have to adapt and adjust. Let's take a step back and ask what the regulatory trends have been over a longer period of time. This is a story that you know all very well. We have less structural regulations in terms of restrictions on banks' operations, let's say on entry or on branching. We have less conduct regulations. We have replaced it with more capital-based, market-based disclosure. At the same time, however, we still had a large safety net. So we have been balancing the rules away from structure and conduct towards a more capital-based, self-regulatory, discipline-based regulation. That has worked to some degree. We had a big financial crisis, so we shouldn't be saying that it has worked perfectly well. And we have come back now to some degree in reversing some of those regulatory trends, both on the structural side as well as on the conduct side. I'm not going to review these issues. They're in Darrel's paper. I've talked about it as well. I think basically we're still doing that within limits. We still haven't tested many of these issues. We're in the early days in terms of reform agenda. So Benoît points, where are we? We're still in the early overall, I would say. But there are a lot of things that I want to come back to that we still have to revisit in the context of moving also towards more market-based finance. So what are these the starting point for revisiting regulation? Well, I think in many ways it really comes down to very fundamental issues in terms of, let's say, the legal system, the property rights, the overall approach towards markets. And of course, here, common law, civil law issues come to play. I'm just picking out here one comparison I think that is important to keep in mind. If you look at the elasticity of bank development to creditor rights, that's the chart on the left, and you have four quartiles, and you ask, if you move from the lowest to the highest quartile, was the increase in bank development, you double the bank development. So the worst creditor right and the best one. If you ask the stock market, you do the same thing, you triple the level of stock market development. It's a very simplistic way to say property rights are going to be key to developing those equity market-based ones. And that's a really fundamental issue, of course, outside the regulatory sphere, but you have to keep it in mind. Many other factors here. Darrel mentioned some. I think taxation is obviously important, but it's also important that we keep in mind the big political economy that favors banks in many, many countries. Is there then a role for regulation? I think so, yes. I'm going to talk about five issues, sets of issues, and I think they're increasingly already being addressed. The first one, for sure, this is really about shadow banking. How do we avoid perverse links between banks and shadow banking? I call it reducing the push from the banking system towards the shadow banking system. It's in the FSB agenda, including in that, I would say, reducing the regulatory and legal privileges for volatile financing, the safe harbor issues. It's in Darrel's papers as well. And there's some role for structural limits, as in the Volcker and Liikanen and Vickers rule. agendas underway. I won't spend much time on it. Second is regulating within the non-bank systems. It's not just reducing the links, the perverse links between banks and shadow banks, but we also have to regulate within the banking's, the non-banking system. And here we can do it in a direct way and an indirect way. The indirect way is has been done in security market financing, make it more costly for banks to extend financing to the more risky forms of the non-banks financing, and that will give some less procyclicality, less risk. We can also do it in a direct way, minimum haircuts. We can do through the early redemption fees and gates. There are many ways in which we can adopt a little bit more through the cycle approach in this area, and I think a lot of the things are on the way as well. I would add to that that we need much better data in this segment of the market. We need to know much more, and I think we can actually do much, much better in terms of disclosing issues. The margins we still don't know necessarily. We still don't know the exposures on aggregate level. Third area is to approach these whole non-bank markets in a little bit more system or a systematic way. And one of these issues is regulating in a more consistent way. I've talked about activity approach, but there's also a financial institutions approach where we still don't necessarily regulate the same type of entity that does the same type of function in the same way. So whether it's broker-dealers or whether it's investment banks, they sometimes fall in different regulatory buckets, the regulatory regimes, and as a consequence, we don't regulate them necessarily, although they act like a bank in terms of maturity transformation or money issuance, but they are falling outside of a regulatory apparatus. And we should then, however, not fall under the temptation of regulating everything like a bank. There are many ones that do not need the same regulation. So I'm not arguing for the same regulation for everybody. I'm arguing for consistent regulation according to the function that you perform. In addition to that, the macroprudential approach for capital market activity, we have started to move there, but I think we need to go much, much further in terms of thinking of systemic risk externalities in the same way that we have started to do within the banking system in terms of looking at the overall risk, the interactions, the externalities. And again, this through the cycle approach is important, that both on the bottom in terms of, let's say, minimum haircuts, but also on the top in terms of maximum haircuts, we have a much more longer-term perspective. That will have to involve somewhat a discretionary approach in terms of the same as the third pillar in Basel, that we sometimes have add-on requirements in terms of capital liquidity for systemically important institutions. And we need to be willing to do that because I think otherwise we're really going to be losing the battle in the non-market financing. Fourth, and this is something that is easier said, and Benoît alluded that we need to have a more gender equilibrium approach. I'm skeptical that we ever will have this gender equilibrium approach really worked out, but I think there are still some low-hanging fruits to be made. So Charles mentioned housing financing. Where do we want housing financing to occur? We have views on that. We can, through regulation, through the risk weights and otherwise, put it in the bucket where it makes the least risk for the overall system. And I think there are other issues as well. If we think procyclicality is a problem of some types of financing, let's not move it to an area of non-market financing where we're going to apply the same kind of regulations, let's say solvency to insurance companies. We're just making the system more volatile in another part. We're not really gaining it. So we need to have a comparative advantage. Which is the best provider on the demand on the supply side? Let's match that with the demand side. I give some other examples here as well, and I think we can do a lot better, although it's hard to do gender equilibrium. There is scope for improvement. Lastly, I think the issues for regulatory governance and regulatory mandates. Obviously, regulators on the capital market side are loath to take on a system-wide view, but I think it's unavoidable that they do, and we should tell them to do so, we meaning the public, the national parliaments, to give them a more mandate for system oversight so that they can indeed look at the risk within a more comprehensive perspective. It's not going to be everything. We still have to have the market discipline as well. And I think there are proposals in which we can make the market take some clues from prices and from information such that you start to behave more rational. I think the way in that sense to have market discipline, regulatory discipline coincide. We're already doing that in banking, right? I mean, a bank regulator would look at market prices, and you can think of the TLAC and the like as making regulatory and market discipline cooperate. We can do something similar in terms of the really non-bank financing as well. That means some adaptation of the governance of the toolkit. It can, like I said, not have full predictability. It can use key principles, but from time to time, it has to have some discretion. And again, in the banks, we do that. The stress tests have some discretion. We can also apply some of that using high-level principles to the non-banks as well. So main message, market-based financing, we would like to have it increased. That may come with some more volatility. I think there are ways in which we can adapt regulation such that we minimize the cost of that procyclicality and yet gain the benefits of the more equity-based, the more market-based financing, which is key for importance for growth. I'm giving you some clues here, but I would want to end up with the last three, point number three, is that we want to be careful to adopt bank-type regulations towards non-market-based financing. This is not necessarily the best thing. These forms of financing are different. We're going to extend the regulatory perimeter, and we're going to make too much of the same kind of financing if we keep doing that. We need to extend the macroprudential approach to the non-bank, but we need to make it specific to the systemic risk, the externalities that exist in that market. And lastly, we need to ensure systemic oversight. We need to have the regulatory governance improvement there to make sure it works. I have two slides with caveats and qualifications, but I'm going to leave those to the discussants. I'm sure he will bring up some issues in that respect. Thank you very much.
Let me just start by saying it's a great pleasure to be here and to discuss this very good paper. As you saw, there are two themes in this paper. I recommend this paper to you because it's a very short but a very comprehensive overview of the issues. The first theme is that financial structure matters for efficiency and risks. So that, in some ways, may sound quite obvious, but actually there are some very important points underlying that. And the second is that regulation should also take account of the financial structure. Now, what are some of the dimensions of financial structure? Well, one is, as Stijn described, the difference between a bank-based system versus a market-based system. But even here, it turns out that that distinction may not capture everything. In fact, it's actually much more about how the financial intermediaries conduct their intermediation activities. And the banks versus markets distinction spills over into the intermediation activities. And I'll say more about this shortly. There are also three other themes in the paper about regulation. The first is procyclicality. How does procyclicality depend on the financial structure? To what extent can you do something about it through macroprudential regulation? And how do non-banks fit into this picture? So let me organize the discussion with this chart. And here we have ultimate creditors on the right-hand side, and then there are debtors on the left-hand side. And the flows go from right to left. That's because liabilities are on the right-hand side of the balance sheet and the assets are on the left-hand side. We typically think of the intermediation happening through banks in this way, but then we say there's also a market-based direct intermediation, and typically we could think of this as the bond market for corporates. And in fact, if we look at just this distinction, intermediated versus the direct financing, the pattern actually looks very different. And what I've done here is to go to the US flow of funds and go to the non-financial corporate business sector liability side and ask what happens over the cycle to the borrowing of non-financial corporates in the US from banks on the one hand and from the bond market on the other. So the red bars are the quarterly growth in the total amounts outstanding of loans, and the blue bars are the quarterly changes in the amounts of bonds outstanding. And the gray vertical bars are periods of recession in the US. And what you clearly see is that the red and the blue bars behave very differently. So after a recession, you see the red bars going into negative territory, so the loans are contracting. But the bonds are actually, the bond market is stepping up to the plate. It's actually acting as a spare tire. And we see it especially in the most recent crisis. So whereas bank lending was booming before the onset of the crisis, it really shrank very sharply. But then we had the bond market stepping in. Of course, the other story behind this is that spreads were exploding. And so there was a huge demand for funding, which was being met by the bond market. Now, if you see this chart, you may wonder, what was Stijn talking about when he said that the market-based system is more pro-cyclical? You may have said, well, perhaps the market-based system isn't so pro-cyclical. But actually, what we should consider is rather what's going on in the intermediation box itself. So let's think of this initial position. Think of this as the situation in the movie It's a Wonderful Life, so the Jimmy Stewart movie that some of you who spent time in the US will know. This is the depositors are financing mortgages of the borrowers, and that's basically it. So the funding is coming from the deposits, and all the lending is in mortgages. But suppose that we open up this financial system. We open it up to wholesale funding. What will happen is that as the intermediaries expand, new borrowers will have access to credit. And almost by definition, the new borrowers are those who were not granted credit before the expansion. And if you believe that the ordering is by credit quality, then the new borrowers will have a lower, so the new loans will have a lower credit quality. But the interesting thing is what's happening on the liability side, because this new lending is being financed somehow. And if we look at the liability side, the new creditors will be those creditors who were not providing funding to the system before, but are now doing so. So typically, this will be wholesale funding, wholesale funding sometimes from abroad. Now, let's look at this from the perspective of Spain. And what I've done here is just take some data from the Bank of Spain's website. And these are the categories of lending by Spanish banks. And the way to look at this is the bottom portion in green are the loans to non-financial corporates that are unrelated to the property sector. And then the dark blue strip at the top is some miscellaneous household lending. But everything in gray in the middle has something to do with housing. And this is very much reinforcing Charles's point earlier. So for example, we have credit for home ownership, loans for real estate financing, credit for construction, et cetera, credit for consumer durables and for home improvement. If we think back to the eve of the euro, so it's the end of 1998, the total face value of loans by the Spanish banking sector was 414 billion euros. And over the next 10 years, that grew fivefold. So there's a huge expansion of lending. Now the question is, how was this being financed? So what's on the liability side? If we look at the liability side, at least from the deposits, what we see is that almost coincidentally, at the end of 1998, total deposit funding of the Spanish banks was almost exactly the same number, 413 billion. So for every euro of lending being done by Spanish banks, there was a deposit of a Spanish household or a Spanish firm. Now, the deposits also increased, but by far less. And if we superimpose the two, the red and the yellow is the difference between the lending and the deposit funding. So whereas at the beginning of the period, there was no difference between the lending and the deposit funding, by the end of the period, we have a huge gap. A lot of the funding here was in the form of covered bonds, so they were long-term securities. They are not runnable in the same way that short-term wholesale funding was. But nevertheless, it was a lot of it was being provided by foreign investors. So this was the current account deficit being financed through the banking sector, through long-term liabilities. And at the end of the period, we have the yellow, which is the Euro system funding for the Spanish banks. So what are the lessons there? The lesson there is that we should look at both sides of the balance sheet. We have to think about where are the liabilities coming from. And here we have to distinguish, I think, quite sharply between runnable deposits and runnable funding, which is short-term funding, and long-term financing. But nevertheless, even if the financing is long-term and quite stable, it is non-core financing to the extent that this is coming from new liabilities that are being generated as the balance sheet expands. So if you believe that you have to do something about this beforehand and lean against this type of expansion, you may invoke some macroprudential tools. And here, one taxonomy would be to say, let's go to the diagram we had before and have a taxonomy where we distinguish the tools by whether they operate on the asset side, whether they operate on the balance sheet as a whole, or whether they operate on the liability side. The asset side tools would include things like LTV and debt service to income caps. There are tools that operate on the whole balance sheet, like the Basel III countercyclical capital buffer, or the leverage cap. And you could also imagine tools that are operating on the liability side. And here, the Korean FX measures would be one example of that, where you could either put a levy on some wholesale funding, or you could actually also provide further restrictions on the liability side, on foreign currency mismatch, and so on. Now, one interesting topic here is the similarity between some of those measures and monetary policy. What if we think about monetary policy as being something which operates on the balance sheet of intermediaries as well? And here, there is a lot of commonality. By raising interest rates, what you're doing is you're postponing spending by you're postponing spending through the price mechanism, and macroprudential policy that restricts credit is also a way of postponing spending. Monetary policy that operates on the leverage of the intermediary, the risk-taking channel, is another way to restrain the activity of the intermediary. And quite clearly, monetary policy that raises the funding cost is something that operates on the liability side. So to that extent, there is a lot of commonality. But I would say that there are two crucial differences between macroprudential policy and monetary policy. That is that with monetary policy, this is something that operates across the whole system. As Jeremy Stijn says, this is monetary policy gets into all the cracks. Whereas if you believe that there are hotspots and you can operate on specific sectors, you would want to use specific macroprudential tools. But I think the far more important point is the second one, which is the fact that with macroprudential policy, you're better able to deal with global factors. And let me introduce that discussion in the remaining 3 minutes by telling you about the currency swap market. So what these charts show you are the difference between the interest rate on the euro that you can extract from the foreign exchange market and the interest rate of the euro in the money market. The principle of covered interest parity is the statement that those two interest rates should be the same. Otherwise, there'll be an arbitrage opportunity. So covered interest parity says that the interest rate that's implicit in the foreign exchange market should be the same as the interest rate in the money market. But whereas that principle held before the crisis, that principle has now completely broken down. What we see is a divergence of these interest rates. And the left-hand panel shows you the cost advantage of borrowing euros through an FX swap. And in an FX swap, what you do is you pledge one of these currencies, the yen, Norwegian krona, Danish krona, or the Swedish krona, and then you borrow euros instead. And in the forward rate, which is the agreed rate at which you unwind, you can then, from the forward rate and the current spot rate, you can work out the implied interest rate on the euro. For most currencies, the difference turns out to be negative in the sense that it's more expensive to borrow euros in the foreign exchange market than it is just to borrow in the currency market. But there are two conspicuous exceptions in this region, which is the Norwegian krona and the Swedish krona. So in Sweden, what this suggests is that there is an abundance of euros. So the euro interest rate that you can borrow at by pledging Swedish krona is actually lower than the euro interest rate that you can borrow in the money market. And one very important reason is this. And this chart shows you the total amount of euro-denominated bond issuance by the banking sector on the left-hand panel in the euro area and in Sweden on the right-hand panel. And the size of the bubble indicates the face value. So how much euro-denominated bonds are you issuing? And the height of the bubble is the maturity. What's the weighted average maturity of the bonds? Now, in the euro area, we see that the bubbles are getting smaller. So the banks are issuing less bonds. There's less wholesale funding going on. But it's at a longer and longer maturity because the yield curve is now much shallower. In Sweden, it's actually not much smaller than before the crisis, and the maturity is also very high. And what's going on here is that in Sweden, as in many countries with a very large pension fund sector, most of the household wealth is locked up in the pension funds. And so the banks are borrowing in the wholesale market and then swapping the borrowed funds in euros and dollars sometimes and lending to domestic borrowers in Swedish krona. So there is, if you like, an abundance of euros in that respect because the banks are now providing that. What this raises, and I'll finish here, is that if we have this global dimension, monetary policy itself is going to be very ineffective in addressing that because then you're going to have to operate in the whole economy rather than on the specific sectors. And any macroprudential instrument is also going to be quite leaky. It'll be a leaky bucket. But the question is a leaky bucket better than no bucket at all? And if you have a second best perspective, you may argue that that is indeed the case. And in some respects, it's really a matter of how long can I hang on before the global financial cycle actually turns. Let me finish there.
So thank you very much to all speakers. That was an incredibly rich set of papers. Before I open the discussion, I would first turn back to the speakers to comment on each other. But let me make three short comments and put one request to the audience. So the comments are the following. First, it's really a pity that Mark Carney couldn't join for many reasons, for broader reasons, but also because if Mark would have been here, he would certainly have stressed how much the FSB has achieved and is achieving to answer some of the questions that have been asked today, in particular when it comes to improving incentives, and that was very much in Charles' discussion, incentives for shareholders and bondholders, and that's TLAC and all what comes with TLAC. Incentives for bank management, and that's compensation policies, so there can be a discussion, but still a lot has been done, and maybe some more can be done on individual liabilities for bank managers, so it's still an open discussion. Also in terms of broadening the scope of the discussion, and that's a guidance that has been recently issued on asset management, work being done on insurance, work being done on CCPs, which Darrel mentioned, and there will be two important reports by CPMI and IOSCO coming in July on CCPs. And that's, I mean, a lot is being done. The second remark is that still what comes from your presentations and what I take from your presentation is that so far the regulatory approach, so the regulatory answer has been piecemeal. And so what we're trying to do together today is also to connect the dots and put some sense into that discussion in a more systemic perspective. It has been very piecemeal, which runs two risks. First risk is to lose sight of the way procyclicality can develop at a global level, and that was Hyun's discussion. A lot has been done against procyclicality, but in a piecemeal, partial equilibrium way, segment by segment, industry by industry, and not that much at a global level, also out of lack of relevant data, as we know. And that raises a broader issue, which is that the regulatory discussion has been very much led by vested interests because it has been segment by segment, losing sight of public interest at some point. And the second risk is that we lose sight of efficiency considerations, and that was also very important in your discussions, that it's usually not the same people who care about stability and who care about efficiency. That's the bureaucratic dimension of it. And so it's also time to reconsider the efficiency consequences of what we've been doing in terms of allocating capital to the right places. And the third remark is that there was one word was totally absent of the discussion, and that was fintech. So Stijn spoke a little bit to technical change and the way it can shift boundaries, incentives. I'm not as thrilled by fintech as some are. I mean, a lot of it is not technological at all. Some of it will have disappeared by the time we do understand it. So it may not be worth spending that much time on it. But still, this has the potential to shift the boundary of the banking industry, to significantly raise the importance of the footprint of non-banks. And so that can change the landscape that Stijn was describing. And it also has the potential to change the way economies of scales are produced in that industry and the way and the kind of choice between decentralized and centralized approaches to financial intermediation. And I was in a FSB discussion recently, and I'm not giving names, but we were discussing blockchain, and somebody said, oh, but blockchain is a fantastic opportunity because the whole system can be more decentralized, which will make it safer, which is more or less the opposite of everything we've tried to achieve over the last 5 years. So that was an interesting remark. So it shows that fintech can shake a little bit the discussion by changing the technology. So I stop it here. I let me first give an opportunity to all speakers to come back, and then I'll open the floor more broadly. So who would like to start? Darrel?
Thank you, Benoît. And first of all, let me reinforce what you said about the important work done by the Financial Stability Board. In my report, I emphasize that the FSB, your committee, the CPMI, the Committee on Payments and Market Infrastructure, IOSCO, Basel Committee on Banking Supervision, all of this progress that I described would not have been possible without G20 coordination through these committees. Very important. And that's why I mentioned that maybe we should have a financial efficiency board in addition to get some more harmonization on getting financial markets trading efficient.
But then the two boards would fight against each other, I guess.
A little bit of competition is good. We know about that in the US. The only remark I would like to make about Charles' very helpful discussion is on what to do about the supplementary leverage ratio. And I guess we have a mild difference of opinion. Charles mentioned one thing we could do is to remeasure the amount of assets involved so that it's more commensurate, for example, by netting. The other alternative that he mentioned is to increase the risk weights, at least on some assets, and I would argue in favor of both of those. And the third option, and by the way, the suggestion that increasing risk weights is very complicated. That's not complicated. You just put a floor on all of them, not as high as the supplementary leverage ratio, and that takes care of this sovereign debt problem where it isn't the banks causing the distortion, it's the regulators saying zero risk weight on sovereign bonds. The third option I mentioned in my paper is to follow the European model on market infrastructure, where Europe has direct repo. We don't need to use the balance sheets of the banks to do this job. If it's government securities repo, we can do all-to-all direct repo. About 50% of European repo trade is done direct repo, and more central counterparty, so that, again, we don't use the bank balance sheets. This is crucially important in the government securities market. It's the basis for market liquidity of bonds, of course, but also for hedging. And for monetary policy, we're going to hear at Jackson Hole this summer a lot about why a effective government securities repo market is so important to central banks to get monetary policy transmission. So I'll pass the baton.
Thank you, Darrel. Stijn?
I am not here to criticize the FSB. They have done a great deal and have achieved it quite a bit. But there are some issues that are just outside the mandate, and by definition almost. One of the issues is, of course, regulatory governance. I think that is an important who has oversight about the non-bank markets. I think that's a big ticket item that we have to address as a community as a whole. You mentioned it, efficiency is not always on the agenda, and the gender equilibrium approach, of course, is very difficult, but there, I think there is progress to be made, so I would encourage at least building in some more trade-off analysis ex ante in the regulatory design so that we get a better cost-benefit analysis. And I know those words are often misused, but I think we need to do at least, even in a partial equilibrium sense, some of that. On your issue on fintech, people will differ on it. I am still worried that down the road we're going to have a system somewhat similar to utilities, where the marginal provider is the solar guy and he gets the benefit of it. But then the core utilities have to be paid for by somebody else, and then we're going to get some stranded assets. And we can think of banks, some of them in Europe, having that stranded asset because of having to support the basic payment system and what have you, but not having the ability to generate profit enough because that's being marginalized around the system. And along with that fintech kind of a world, we're going to have more peak pricing, the Uber pricing, in which you cannot get your car at a certain point unless you pay $1,000 per minute or something like that. And I think that is a problem for the system as a whole as well. So I think we have to be more careful about that dimension, I would say. The last point on Darrel on the leverage ratio, again, one can differ on it. But in some sense, the evidence that you mentioned in which you said the prices are starting to diverge a little bit, maybe that was the intention. You're arguing that it shouldn't have been the intention, but maybe some of that was the idea to have some more frictions and some more cost in the system to discourage some of that.
Yep. Thank you, Stijn. Charles, no.
Well, and the FSB has done a lot, and there's a lot that is being improved in regulation. And I focused on things that hadn't been done, so I wasn't intending to be fair or give a sort of balanced account. And the best thing that I think the regulators have done is the greater reliance on stress tests, which I think is a huge improvement. My worry is that you have put too much of your reputation on bail-in working, and I'm a bail-in skeptic. I just don't think if it's a systemic crisis, I just don't think it'll work. I think it'll give you'll have about 4 days before you fall back and bail out.
Okay. No, I'm not commenting. Sure.
Thank you, Benoît. Could I take a slightly different perspective on the leverage ratio than Darrel did, and we've had this discussion before. I think it would be somewhat simplistic to say that some of the strains that we're seeing are purely due to regulation. And let me cite some evidence for why it may not simply be regulation. Over the weekend, the BIS put out the annual report, and If you look at my presentation that's on the BIS website, so could I just put in a plug for that? There is a chart that I think you will find very interesting, which is getting a sense of where the strains of financial intermediaries are showing up. And one area is the breakdown of covered interest parity. So the one chart that I showed you was just to illustrate the funding balance within each market. But it turns out that covered interest parity is now failing in a pretty widespread way. And that's a very good indicator of the shadow value of balance sheet capacity, because the intermediaries could take leverage, then they would just borrow at the low rate and lend out at the high rate and just close the gap. The fact that that is not happening is quite indicative of there being some limits on the capacity. Now, the question is that due to regulation or is it due to other market risk factors? And if we think back to what was happening in the deleveraging, the very sharp deleveraging at the height of the crisis, that wasn't due to regulation. That was the tightening financial conditions, raising the haircuts on repos, and just generally leading to a downward spiral. And one of the charts in my presentation, so please come to the BIS website and take a look at those slides, shows that the value of the dollar is a very good indicator of balance sheet stress. And if you look at the euro dollar cross-currency basis at almost at a daily frequency, you see that that's actually a function of the value of the dollar. And why is it the dollar? Well, because there's a lot of dollar debts out there. And it turns out not only in the emerging markets, but also in advanced economies, for reasons that I won't go into now. And as the dollar goes up, that is tightening financial conditions. In the regressions, it turns out that the value of the dollar has a very similar impact as the VIX. A higher dollar has a very similar impact as an increase in the VIX. So to the extent that regulation doesn't change from one day to the next like that, this is daily frequency, I think it's not just regulation. Now, there may be some complex interaction between regulation and market risk factors, but I think it would be simplistic to say that it's just regulation. And if it is a complex interaction, I think we have to ask, how does that interaction take place? And I think at face value, a much simpler hypothesis is that these strains are showing because of market risk factors, because at the juncture of the global financial cycle that we find ourselves in right now, there are some tensions out there that just have to do with the natural cycle.
Thank you, Hyun. Let me open the floor. So I've got Richard Portes first.
Two questions on what can be done, as it were. One is for Darrel, and Benoît spoke about two reports forthcoming on central counterparties. Darrel, in your paper, you talk a little bit about central counterparties and indicate some disquiet, if I might say, some worries about the risks there. And I'm wondering what you might tell us about what you think ought to be done to mitigate those risks. And the second is for Stijn. It's about data. We now have lots and lots of data, especially in Europe. We've got EMIR producing huge amounts of data on the derivatives markets, but we still have major areas of obscurity. For example, ESRB are publishing in the summer a first edition of a shadow banking monitor. But when you look at it, and it makes considerable progress, but when you look at it, the data behind it are limited, very, very limited. And we know very little about, for example, synthetic levers. We know very little about exposures as between the banking system and the shadow banking system. What can be done to get the system to produce more data and to make it available to the different to the regulators and to researchers? Of course, I come for that.
Thank you.
Uh,
Thank you, Richard. Let me ask you to be really short because there are many, many questions. And let me also apologize if I don't give all your names because sometimes I just can't see you very well. But I could see Anil here at the back. Can you stand up? Yeah.
So as long as we're inventing new regulators, I'd like a shadow banking Basel committee. And I would charge the shadow banking committee to do two things. If you look at Darrel's list from the FSB on page 37 of how they classify shadow banking, it really comes to two things. It's credit extension and maturity transformation. And it seems like the answer I would like to have is that capital travels with an asset regardless of how it's funded. And you can kind of imagine how that works using something like margin requirements that are attached to an asset. I don't see how to do the analog of a liquidity requirement that taxes maturity transformation in all the various other ways. So I wonder if you have some thoughts on how that could be done.
Thank you, Katie Mann.
Well, I really appreciate Stijn's comment that we should balance the probability of risk against the likely reduction in mean growth. That's a very important trade-off that is very real in the data. We have some very good research on that. But I'd like to take that to Benoit's request for us to think about the international aspect and ask the question, what do we do when we have the risk, mean growth, preferences different across different countries, and we have international capital flows, because there's an inconsistency.
Okay, let me stop it here for the time being and go back to the panel.
I'll take the first question that Richard passed out. What do we do about the risks that's being created by these giant new central counterparties? In my report, I discussed two areas that should be addressed. Number one, we need a global stress test framework. Right now, there's regulatory stress tests are just getting started. ESMA has conducted one. It reports the results as satisfactory with some quibbles. But as Benoît mentioned in his speech at ESRB, we don't yet have, and his committee is promoting, a global stress test framework so that there's comparability across the globe on central counterparties. If a bank, major bank, fails in one CCP, it's going to be failing in many CCPs. We need a high standard for how those stress tests are done. Second area, failure resolution. That is surprisingly late, and I'm not sure why. We've been very successful in moving all these swaps into the CCPs. We have yet to have a framework, or even any jurisdiction has yet to announce what its plan would be, an operating manual for what to do that we already have in the area of financial institutions. The United States, as I mentioned in my remarks this morning, is the slowest in this area in the sense that no single agency in the United States has even stood up and said, we are working on a plan, let alone having a date for a plan or having a plan in hand. And so I think to the extent that regulators can put some heat on each other, I'm sure discussions are happening in the background, but pushing this up the agenda, it's not as though it's going to happen in the next month, year, or even a few years. But although remote, it needs to be done because it could happen someday, and it's important.
So on the European side, we're having intense discussions on CCP resolution in our community, and the Commission will soon come with a text on CCP recovery and resolution, presumably in September, I guess. But they will be ahead of the US, and there will be no global framework yet. On supervisory stress testing for CCPs, it's an incredibly important project, but it's an enormous project. So we are still we're standing at the foot of the mountain, and we've got that mountain to climb. It will take years. So the sooner the better, but don't be too impatient about it. It will take years.
mean, the question of Richard on data, I think it even goes beyond the shadow banking. I think even in banking, we're not there yet. It's still surprising to me that I can get data from the website of an emerging market country about individual banks, and I have a challenge doing that for Europe. And some people have actually commented that since the crisis, maybe transparency on even on the banking side has declined. Nicolas Veron has some analysis on that. So I think we need to do better in many ways, because otherwise we're not going to get market discipline, obviously, to work. In a shadow banking, that's always going to be very challenging, and it goes back to the regulatory governance. We need the security market regulators to be willing to analyze and use the data, and that's typically not the case. This is more the legal SEC mentality from some of these regulators, and I think that's a big challenge to be done, because the data are there, and we increasingly have that, and it's going to be a big data, in some sense, overload unless we put in place the analytical apparatus to make these data usable. Synthetic leverage, you mentioned specifically, that is going to be very, very challenging conceptually and everywhere. I mean, I know IOSCO has been asked last week about FSB to start developing some templates and some standards, etc. I think we're never going to get one single view on this. So we'll have to improvise to some degree. But yes, I agree wholeheartedly with you. On Katie's point, I'm not sure that if you have big risk preferences of countries in the risk-return trade-off, that capital flows may necessarily make things worse. In some sense, you could argue, well, that allows for risk to be diversified and risk views to be, it's like the equivalent to diversity within the financial domestic system, right? So if people have different risk preferences, having more ability to have access a larger set of assets and a larger set of investment opportunities, it may actually improve the ability to achieve these different risk preferences. Yes, maybe we'll need some prudential approaches, maybe in some cases capital flow approach, management approaches as well, but I'm not sure it is necessarily inconsistency.
Can I just pick up on Cathy's point about capital flows and the trade-off between efficiency and stability? I think I would have a slightly more nuanced view on this, because to the extent that equity is the base on which you can build leverage, having more equity actually may also be conducive to better macro outcomes as well. And in that context, it really is a puzzle why slow-moving capital, in Darrel's terminology, why slow-moving capital isn't flowing in to take advantage of these market anomalies and close the gap. The gaps are actually very, very large. And I suspect that one element of the story is the very low market-to-book ratios. We know that in Tobin's Q theory, if the market-to-book ratio is less than one, you're better off by liquidating the firm. Well, if it's the bank, how would you liquidate the bank? Well, you would then take out some of the capital. And so the incentive to pay dividends is actually higher as the market-to-book ratio becomes lower. And I think this really puts the focus on the business model of banks. I think if we want to fix many of the ills that are out there, I think we do need to have, a very detailed look at the business models. What is actually driving the market-to-book ratio so low? I think as long as the market-to-book ratio is so low, we're not going to see that much retention of capital, and therefore it's not conducive to increasing the capacity of the banking sector.
Yeah. It's a forecast of very, very low interest rates that have been driving that, and the very low profitability that are prospective. I think my main criticism of the regulators is not what they've done, but that they haven't taken into account the impact of what they've done on the commercial banks' business models, and therefore what the commercial banks are likely to do. So every time they drive down interest rates, they screw the banks, and the banks don't lend, and they get absolutely nowhere. What's the point?